sorry?
There's no video inside.
How? We're here to do a documentary.
There's still no video recording.
How do we do a documentary without recording? Is there somebody we can speak to about...
Only if you stop
video. I gotta go Apple Puppy Bear. Okay? Alright, I'll be back. I love you. I gotta go take care of this iTunes thing once and for all. Okay?
I've been a musician for as long as I can remember. In fact, I first sat down on a set of drums and actually played simple rhythmic patterns before I could even walk. That was more than 50 years ago, and to say the music business has changed would be an understatement. Or would it? In many ways, nothing about the music industry has changed at all. Artists, bands, songwriters, musicians around the world continue to get screwed out of royalties they will never ever see. It's just the way it has always been, and for whatever reason, most artists seem to accept the fact that there is nothing they can do about it. Well, that's about to change. Back in the day when I played the club circuit, we performed at many famous venues, including the Whiskey, the Roxy, and the Troubadour. Back then, in order to get on the radio, you needed to pay off the DJs if you wanted any shot at all of being on rotation. This was commonly known as payola. In the 1960s, it took an act of Congress to make such payments a crime, but that did not deter the determined. And the fact is, it's much worse today. One of the most notorious incidents involving payola was the controversy surrounding Alan Freed. A disc jockey and early supporter of rock and roll, Freed's career ended when it was shown that he had accepted payola, a practice that was highly controversial at the time. There was also a conflict of interest that he had taken songwriting co-credits, most notably on Chuck Berry's Maybelline, which entitled him to receive a part of the song's royalties, which he could help increase by heavily promoting the record on his own program.
Interesting, yeah. Okay. I'm curious. You mentioned the magic word right as we went into the Bee Gees film. You said something about the Doors. What is the favorite song that you have?
Crystal Ship.
just so happens that that's what they're going to do. So that makes a nice introduction.
It does.
So ladies and gentlemen, would you please greet the Doors?
Before you slip into unconsciousness.
Another famous case involved the late Dick Clark. His career was also nearly derailed by the Payola scandal, but he avoided trouble by selling his stake in a record company and cooperating with authorities. The amount of money involved is largely unpublished. However, one DJ, Phil Lind of WAIT in Chicago, had disclosed in congressional hearings that he had once taken $22,000 to play a record.
The days are bright and filled with pain. Enclose me in your gentle rain.
In more recent times, former New York State Attorney General Elliot Spitzer alleged that Universal Music had used a broad array of illegal pay-for-play tactics to secure airplay for its music, including bribing the programmers with laptop computers, tickets to sporting events, and luxury hotel stays. Universal Music paid $12 million to settle the case. In addition, both Warner Brothers and Sony BMG agreed to pay $5 and $10 million respectively, thus proving the ongoing antitrust violations that are still prevalent today.
Your freedom lies the streets of fields that never die.
As we continued up the 500-mile trail to Apple headquarters, I couldn't help but stop and think, what the hell led us to this point? Why would a company like Apple, a company I've been so fond of and such a loyal customer of since 1991, do the things they were doing to music artists all over the world? It all started 10 years ago in 2006, when I started growing suspicious of my iTunes aggregator. An iTunes aggregator, or aggravator, as I like to refer to them as, is a third-party music distributor assigned by Apple to be the go-between, or middleman, separating Apple from the musicians, thus creating a stonewall effect. In a nutshell, here's how it works. If you're a musician or a band and you'd like to have your songs available on iTunes, the world's largest music content provider, you must first submit your material through an approved iTunes aggregator. Once your material is delivered to the aggregator, they in turn will deliver said material to iTunes. And within a few days, sometimes weeks, the material is available for customers to purchase and download via the Apple iTunes website. It all sounds so pleasantly simple, and probably would be if Apple weren't blatantly ignoring federal antitrust laws. Let's examine these antitrust laws, specifically the Cartwright Act. The Cartwright Act prohibits combinations of two or more persons, capital, skill, or acts to restrict trade or commerce. Price fixing. Agreement between competitors to buy or sell products, services, or commodities at a fixed price or rate. Group boycotting. Competitors agreeing to boycott a certain entity. Market division scheme. Agreement between competitors to divide markets, products, customers, or territories amongst themselves. exclusive dealings, requiring a buyer or seller to buy or sell all or most of a certain product from a single supplier. Price discrimination. Similar goods to buyers at different prices. Tying. Selling a product or service on the condition that the buyer agrees to also buy a different product or service. So what does this all mean? Well, back in 2006, when I became increasingly suspicious of my iTunes aggregator, I decided to contact them. The aggregator I deal with, and who has complete authority from Apple to report whatever sales numbers they decide, is CD Baby. You see, the problem I thought I was having at the time was the fact that my sales of downloads, specifically from iTunes, were never more than 99 per month. Now, I admit that I wasn't that famous of a musician, but I did have several releases available and was receiving very good reviews. What I couldn't wrap my head around, however, was the fact that there were only two digits in the accounting section of CD Baby. My theory was, if I sold more than 100 songs, it would automatically default to 99. When I reached out to Derek Sievers, founder and former CEO of CD Baby, he told me it was just a technical glitch and that artists were receiving full payment for their actual sales. In 2006, iTunes celebrated its fifth birthday, but for the most part, people were still buying CDs. And even though the iPhone had been invented, it was not released publicly until 2007. So in general, people were not routinely downloading songs to their cell phones. With that being said, I took Derek Sievers for his word and continued about my business. Over the next few years, not only would my suspicions become solidified, but all of the warning signs I thought I'd seen would come into full focus. During the making of this film, these sales reports were taken directly from the CD Baby website. Everything was business as usual at CD Baby. They would pay me on average about 50 or 60 bucks a month. Then out of nowhere, like a bolt of lightning, it hit. On August 30th of 2010, my average sales jumped by more than 1,000%. Now, this was absolutely astonishing to me. How do you explain such a drastic increase? Sure, there were far more smartphones on the planet capable of downloading and storing more MP3s, but I hadn't released any new material, hadn't performed any concerts, and had no real marketing campaigns to speak of. So I decided to reach out to Derek Sievers once again. Derek had relocated to Wellington, New Zealand, after selling CD Baby to disc makers in 2008 for $22 million. Since I didn't have a phone number to contact him directly, I sent him this email to see if he would respond. As time went on and on waiting for my response from Derek Sievers, I started putting all the pieces of the puzzle together. There's something happening. Making money in music, especially enough to actually survive on and earn a living, has never been an easy task. Talented artists worldwide struggle every day to make ends meet. And when a massively corrupt organization like iTunes takes over the world, not only does it make it harder, it makes it downright impossible. My words are not brewed from spite nor malevolence. I speak the truth from getting royally screwed over from iTunes and its counterparts. If everybody's wrong, young people speak in their minds, are getting so much resistance from behind. Time we stop, hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
Just about ready to check out of the hotel and head over to Apple to find out what they have to say about what's been going on iTunes. So, stay tuned. Okay, standing in front of Apple, and we're gonna go inside to see if we can get some questions answered about this iTunes thing going on. All right, let's go. I'm sorry?
There's no video inside.
We're here to do a documentary.
There's still no video recording.
How do we do a documentary without recording? Is there somebody we can speak to about...
Only if you stop video.
We're on high alert here at Apple. They don't want us to go in the building and bust them for all their bullshit.
That's it. Say goodbye to Apple. This is what Apple gave me. Call that number. I'm standing at corporate headquarters, yet I need to call corporate headquarters with no name. That's what they gave me. So we're on the freeway now. We got to drive 500 miles back from this shit bomb because that company right there is going to screw as many people as they can until I publish my documentary. Hello, this is Lance.
Hi, Lance. It's Anna calling from Apple. How are you?
Hi, Anna. I'm doing great. Thanks for your call.
Yeah, of course. I got your inquiry through our helpline, and I kind of just wanted to give you a call and see what was going on and what you were hoping to do.
Yeah, well, you know, I drove up there hoping to get an interview with an iTunes representative. Regarding a documentary that I'm producing, and that didn't happen, so I just wanted to be, you know, see if I could get in touch with somebody from the iTunes department that would be willing to, you know, go on the record and basically just discuss a few of the iTunes policies with you.
And can you just give me a little bit of background on what the documentary is about? Kind of your background, all that stuff.
Yeah, well, I'm a musician. I have a music background. I just completed my first documentary, which actually won the first film festival we entered. We already won. So So I'm moving on to the second one, which I've been contemplating on doing for a while, and you know, the documentary is basically focused on, you know, the distribution and the way iTunes handles its artists and its aggregators.
Mm-hmm. And have you, like, what part of the process are you in?
Incipient phase. I mean, like I said, I drove up there. It was 500 miles for me to drive. Because I couldn't get any real information over the internet of who to contact. When, you know, you basically, when you call iTunes, you get iTunes customer support as if, you know, you're trying to figure out what's going on with something you purchased or whatnot. I'm trying to come in at this, you know, from an artist perspective and trying to ascertain certain aspects of how things work and why they, you know, why the policies are in place that are in place.
Okay. Got it. And I saw your email, one of your emails, was at Harvard?
Yeah.
Are you affiliated with the school at all? Are you a student or?
Yeah, I'm an old guy going to law school.
That's great. Yeah. Okay, and what is your timeline?
You know, I want to release it next year. So you know how these things take. I mean, I use.
So this is a fairly kind of large scale.
Yeah. This will be, you know, as opposed to the one I just produced that won the award. That was a short, and I'm trying to do a feature on this one. So you know, 60 plus minutes, hopefully in the 90 minute range.
Mm-hmm. And what was the name of the previous one?
Crazy Bill.
Got it. Yeah. Okay. Well, as you can imagine, we obviously are very selective in the things that we participate, just, you know, the nature of our company. I will take all this information and circle back with the appropriate people and see what we can do. You know, my best advice would be to kind of continue without our participation, and then if if I can get anything turned around for you, I most definitely will let you know.
Yeah, I mean, that'd be great. Just, you know, somebody who can basically answer things, you know, that directly relates to iTunes. I probably have a half dozen questions, maybe.
Okay.
You know, so.
Yeah, I definitely wanted to make sure I gave you a call because I didn't want your last communication with Apple to be turned down at the front desk. So I'm glad that we were able to get on the phone.
Right, no, I appreciate that.
Yeah, definitely. Okay. I will shoot you an email in the next couple of days then.
Okay, I appreciate that, Anna.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
So after many years of performing, writing, and producing music, I decided it was time to take it all to the next level. My goal was simple. I was to become an iTunes aggregator as advertised on the official Apple website. Now, iTunes used to have a simple iTunes aggregator link on the web, but after learning of my documentary in December of 2015, they changed the entire format. Now it is called iTunes Music Partner Search. How appropriate. Of course, Apple will chalk this up as mere coincidence, but I think not. I go to them in 2015 telling them of my intentions, and they make an entire format change 2 months later? Okay. That's a good one. So let's see. At the time, Apple's requirements for becoming an aggregator were quite costly and time-consuming. We were told, among other things, that we needed a physical location, as in a commercial space. In other words, you could not operate this from your home. Now, earlier in this documentary, you may have noticed this little subliminal message. That's because Tricky Dick Records was the name we chose for our iTunes aggregator agreement with Apple. We leased this commercial space in Yorba Linda, California, to be the official headquarters of Tricky Dick Records. In addition to the commercial space Apple required us to get, they also had these requirements you must have fulfilled before ever being approved as an aggregator. File articles of incorporation with the Secretary of State. Buy ISRC codes from the International Standard of Radio Codes. Get all business licenses and permits required from the city, county, and state. Get a DBA and file a fictitious business statement. Open a business account. Now, to Apple, this was one big carnival act, making people run around, spinning their wheels, spending their money, all the while knowing that in the end, they were not going to get a single thing. Greed is a funny thing. It makes people so blind that they totally lose sight of all morality, integrity, and empathy. Apple's iTunes music division and its conglomerates are the epitome of greed. They have no consideration for humanity, and they are destroying more than just dreams. They are destroying lives. After being rejected by Apple yet again, not even granting me a 5-minute interview, the drive home seemed twice as long. Live and learn from fools and from sages. You know it's true. My next move was to write my congressman, Dr. Raul Ruiz, from the 36th District. Remember when I said it took an act of Congress to make payola a crime back in the 60s? So too with this. I sent him this letter to see if he would respond, but then soon remembered what Apple is all about. How they operate, what they do, and who they screw. With Apple's backdoor deals, they run their business just like a speakeasy, with the deck always stacked in their favor. My congressman responded to me all right, and he said the following. Now, I can understand that he might not be able to meet with me. After all, he's a congressman, and he's busy fighting for our rights in Washington. However, he explicitly said he could not meet with me in the upcoming month due to scheduling conflicts. Now, I never gave him a specific time. I just said any time will work. So much for paying attention to your constituents' letters. Or perhaps there's something else at play here. In April of 2016, Apple hired Cynthia Hogan to run their dog and pony lobby show in Washington, D.C. As a top lobbyist for the NFL and Vice President Joe Biden, Cynthia knows a few things about Washington and how to get exactly what Apple wants. In 2015, Apple paid Washington lobbyists a total of $5 million to get their way. In 2016, that number is expected to double. And in 2017, well, you see where I'm going. Now, that may seem like a lot of money, and in most cases, it is. But in this scenario, it's a mere drop in the bucket for Apple. Apple's highly paid and extremely convincing lobbyists are in Washington so that they can develop the relationships they will need when the time comes. Apple is ramping up for the inevitable and positioning itself for the protection and political power they will need when these blatant violations of the Sherman Antitrust Act and breaches of the aforementioned Cartwright Act finally come to light. Nobody ever said Apple wasn't smart, but it's the greed that will ultimately destroy them. Just like the bandits and bank robbers of yesteryear, Apple seemingly does what it wants with no regard for the law. There is, however, one difference. Outlaws use guns. Apple uses ones and zeros.
How do you feel when you go before Congress and they say, you're a tax avoider?
What I told them and what I'll tell you and the folks watching tonight is we pay more taxes in this country than anyone.
Well, they know that, and you should because of how much money you make.
Well, that I don't deny that. We happily pay
But you also have more money overseas probably than any other
we
American
do,
company.
Because as I said before, 2/3 of our business is over there.
Yeah. But and why so don't you bring that home is the question.
I'd love to bring it home.
Why don't you?
Because it would cost me 40% to bring it home. And I don't think that's a reasonable thing to do. This is a tax code, Charlie, that was made for the industrial age, not the digital age. It's backwards. It's awful for America.
What he's really saying is it's awful for Apple because they're greedy and they want to keep it all.
It should have been fixed many years ago. It's past time to get it done.
But here's what they concluded. Apple is engaged in a sophisticated scheme to pay little or no corporate taxes.
Uh-oh, Charlie. You're pissing off the god.
On $74 billion in revenues held overseas.
That is total political crap. There's no truth behind it. Apple pays every tax dollar we owe.
While Tim Cook continued to spew his garbage all over the airwaves about their tax avoidance scheme, he was served with this demand letter from me about one of his other schemes. Apple's business model for iTunes is quite simple, actually. Get as many artists as possible and funnel them through a few selected aggregators, which they control. This is a business model built on the same principles as their tax avoidance scheme. They simply avoid artists by putting up a shield between them and the artist. This is their defense mechanism, or as they like to call it, their aggregator. Remember, Anna from Apple said they were very selective. Now that's an understatement.
Met my old lover on the street last night.
Burning the candle at both ends, I needed a break from the documentary. So I decided to clear my head and take a road trip to Arizona. A dear old musician friend of mine, James Maciel, was performing in Phoenix with his band Motor Gun Hotel. Getting away for a few days was just what I needed to gather my thoughts, compose the end of the documentary, and put this iTunes thing into the world's hands.
I'm not the kind of man who tends to socialize. I seem to lean on old familiar ways.
Arizona was a great time. Having a few drinks with my old buddies from Motor Gun was just what I needed. Now it was time to head back to my desert and complete the documentary. But before I could call it a wrap, I delved into one of my other favorite passions.
We need smell-o-vision here. Nice. What are those herbs? I think we'd rather look at the steak.
Back in the day when I played the club circuit, we performed at many famous venues, including the Whiskey, the Roxy, and the Troubadour. Back then, in order to get on the radio, you needed to pay off the DJs if you wanted any shot at all of being on rotation. But you know what? It was worth it. It's a hell of a lot better than what you get today. At least in the old days, you got what you paid for. Nowadays, companies like Apple are laying the groundwork for other scam companies. And not only are they leading by example, they're colluding with them. Companies like Radio Airplay, formerly known as Django. Radio Airplay, a company that is widely publicized by CD Baby and protected under the umbrella of Apple, boasts that it can get music artists new fans through its exclusive internet radio play. Internet radio play. What a joke. They have a couple of servers in a Brooklyn basement, and the only ones listening are robots. Do not spend a single penny with this scam company. So back in 2012, when I decided I wanted to be an Apple iTunes aggregator, I went through the very tedious, time-consuming, and costly application process. At the time, there were 11 Apple iTunes approved aggregators. Upon completing this documentary in the fall of 2016, there are 11 Apple iTunes approved aggregators. The same ones as before, the same ones there will always be. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to see what Apple is doing. They have these 11 aggregators in place because they can control them and monopolize the industry. After all, it's much easier to watch over a couple of sheep than a herd of wild horses. What Apple is doing, without any objection from anyone, is violating several federal antitrust laws. By not allowing additional aspiring music distributors to become aggregators, they will never have to answer to anyone about their accounting or lack thereof, and their transparency or lack thereof. It's very difficult to convey to people the sheer magnitude of how monumental this scam is. It's absolutely astounding, and the only way that musicians will ever be able to get to the bottom of this is to take it straight to Congress. When I was refused my aggregator license after complying with all of their requirements, it hurt. It hurt really bad. My business model was simple. I was going to charge a flat $10 fee per album, per artist, and I was going to let the artist keep 100% of the proceeds from all sales. I know from many years of research that I would have easily signed up 100,000 artists in my first 2 years. That would put me at 500,000 plus artists by 2016. At $10 an artist, my annual gross income would have exceeded $5 million a year by now. This is no longer about money. This is about right and wrong, and helping the millions of musicians worldwide that are not getting their royalties. We all need to stand up and unite and demand transparency from this multi-billion dollar fraud. We need to make a change, people, and we need to do it now. Without all of us uniting, we will never, ever conquer the beast. If you could say anything to Apple, what would you say?
Fuck you.